In 1978, in fact, by 1980, I thought I understood what ADHD was, or back at that time it was called the hyperkinetic syndrome, hyperkinesis, or hyperactivity. And because for 2 years I had been the executive director of this residential treatment program for severely emotionally disturbed kids, abused, abandoned, whatnot. My conceptualization at that point in the early and mid-1980s of ADD and ADHD was that it was something that was this severe end of the spectrum, and it was, and I understood that there was a spectrum disorder, and that there were children that were not as severe as what we were dealing with, but it hadn't occurred to me that it might be in my own family, or it might even be me for that matter. And so we took our son to a local educational testing specialist, and I said, you know, running through all the tests, let's figure out what's going on with him. Let's do an IQ test. Let's do the MMPI. Let's do, you know, whatever you've got. I just want to know what's the problem, or what's the condition, or what's the circumstance. And Louise and I left him there for most of the morning, and we came back around lunchtime, and this very well-intentioned fellow, keep in mind the state of the art, this was 20 years ago, more or less, a very well-intentioned fellow, brought our son out and sat him down with Louise and I. And I should preface this by saying that our son is brilliant in many regards, and in particularly in science. It was his love, but the biological sciences. He had all these cichlids, these particular type of fish that he was breeding, and he actually had even bred one that was so unique that he got a journal to name it after him, you know, in the Latin name. I mean, he was quite competent in these areas. So anyway, this fellow brought him out, sat him down, and said to him, in front of Louise and I, "Well, young man, you have a brain disorder," and which is a great way to start, right? And then he proceeded to explain, you know, ADHD. You know, he said it's characterized by easily being distractible, that by being highly impulsive, you know, distractibility, noticing everything around you, impulse, making quick decisions, and high levels, a need for high levels of risk, or a need for high levels of stimulation. And then he said words to the effect of, children like this very often end up in jail, and they very often, in fact, virtually always don't succeed in college. So you need to stay away from the bad kids, and you need to forego any plans you have for college. In fact, are you any good with your hands? And my son was, "Well, yeah, I think so." And he said, "Well, you should check out auto mechanics, and if you go into auto mechanics, be sure that you don't work on American cars, work on the European cars, because they pay so much better." And he said, "I've got a BMW, and it costs me $400 every time I walk in the door. And it's so much more money than a Chrysler or General Motors." And I'm horrified hearing this speech being given to my son about how he is, at the age of 12, going to spend the rest of his life. And, you know, the fellow, in fact, he told him how to be an auto mechanic, he said, "What would you like to be when you grow up? What are your plans?" And you know, "Oh, I'd like to be a marine biologist or go into the biological sciences, you know, when I graduate." And he said, "Well, you can forget that." And he thought he was just being honest, just being blunt, and he was actually telling the story of the day. It was, and tragically, in some regards, it's the story of today, of this day. And so I went on a literature search binge for the next 6 months or so. I ran my own business, and so I could take some fair amount of time off and just to find out everything I could about what was going on with this. What is this ADD? It was called ADD back then. They didn't have the H, and they were starting to sort out variations of it. And what I learned repeatedly was that this was a pathology, that it was of unknown etiology, that it was the prognosis was poor, that the only treatment was stimulant drugs, and that they were occasionally successful and occasionally not, and you know, blah, blah, blah. And there were a couple of early longitudinal studies that indicated that these kids would have long-term life problems, or the studies done in prisons showing that the prisoner population outrepresented the normal population in terms of an ADHD diagnosis or an ADD diagnosis. And as I kept going through this, and reading the diagnostic criteria, I also kept recognizing people that I knew, that I had known in my life, who had been highly successful. And I couldn't synchronize the two. One, for example, Kemmons Wilson was a friend of mine. And he was the publisher of a magazine, a business magazine. So I was reading this article about the early origin, the pre-agriculture societies of humankind. You know, what was the pre-agricultural society like? And what was the and what when did the transition to agriculture happen, and how, what was the nature of that transition to agriculture, and what different changes did we see, not just in our society, but in the behaviors associated with being a member of that society? In a hunting-gathering society, these three behaviors in particular, and many of the others associated with it, would be highly adaptive. As I was drifting off to sleep, I was imagining myself, okay, it's 15, 20,000 years ago, and both my father's parents are Norwegian immigrants to the United States. So I'm in Norway, and I'm hunting for the reindeer and whatever. And if I'm highly focused on the path, I might not notice the animal going by, right? You know, or if I'm if I'm walking through a forest and I'm focused on tracking this rabbit, I might not see the bear that's about to get me. I mean, I'd have to be constantly scanning my environment, just continually aware of everything. And in a classroom, we call that distractibility. You know, the teacher's talking, the kid's noticing the bug walking across the hall, across the ceiling. He's noticing that what the other children are doing. He's noticing the fellow outside mowing the lawn. And then he's trying to multitask, but the teacher is saying, no, focus here, please. And, oh, this must be distractibility. So I thought, okay, that would be an asset. Impulsivity, making quick decisions. Well, if you're chasing a rabbit through the forest and a deer runs by, you don't have time to pull out a pad and a pen and say, well, let's do a risk-benefit analysis. Let's see, deer, rabbit. Deer, more meat, yes. Rabbit, easier to catch, less meat, higher probability. By that time, of course, the rabbit's gone. One of the things that I continually hear is, I had done the action before I knew I'd made the decision, right? See the rabbit, pull the arrow, off it goes, and then you realize that there was a thinking process. Behavior precedes cognition. Behavior preceding cognition is the dictionary definition of impulsivity. And yet this would be highly adaptive behavior in a hunting-gathering society. And then the third behavior was a need for high levels of arousal, a need for high levels of stimulation. Now, in a hunting-gathering society, there are not only opportunities out there called food, there are also dangers, things that want to make you their food. And so in a hunting-gathering society, a person who wakes up in the morning and says, you know what sounds like fun? What sounds like fun is to go out there where there's things that want to eat me as much as I want to eat them and get lunch. Right? That kind of person would be highly adapted. They would be propelled out of the cave in the morning by the challenge, or out of the whatever it may be, tent or hut. Whereas 10,000 years later, or during the post-agricultural revolution in a time of agriculture, things were completely different. As agriculture came along, we needed a different skill set. Because in agriculture, there was no more danger. We fenced off the territory. Here, this is my farm now. I'm putting up fences. The deer are not coming. So the need for high levels of arousal and stimulation, to work backwards from the three, the need for high levels of stimulation and arousal, in fact, not only would no longer be an asset, it would be a liability. Because that person who needs those high levels of stimulation, after a few years or a few months or maybe even a few weeks of playing farmer, let's pick the bugs off the plants all day long, would say, this is boring. I'm out of here. So anyhow, first of all, that need for stimulation in an agricultural society, in a post-hunting-gathering society, in an agricultural society or a post-agricultural society, an industrial society, where instead of picking bugs off plants or putting rice plants in all day long, we're now putting screws on bolts all day long. That need for stimulation, we'd have the reverse. The same thing with impulsivity. There has to be a very careful thought process. On the farmer's side, a farmer could not be impulsive. A farmer couldn't say, you know, we've grown wheat for 30 generations. This is boring. Let's plant that weed right there. That looks pretty. And see what happens. And it turns out that weed's not edible. I mean, farmers have to make decisions at least a season in advance. And that's a long time for somebody with ADHD. I mean, a day is a long time. An hour can be a long time. So the impulsivity would not serve the farmers well. So you would see a natural selection out of the gene pool. And then distractibility. Again, a farmer in an agricultural society would have to, you know, pick bugs off plants, sit bug after bug, plant after plant, hour after hour, day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, generation after generation, right? And think that this was fun, they would have to, yeah? They'd say, oh, this is, I enjoy going out in the field to pick. And today we call these people bookkeepers, you know, it's accountants. There are a number of professions, not to pick on any particular accountant, there are a number of professions where this quality of being able to focus and actually find pleasure in that, in what I would call a boring task, is highly adaptive and very useful in modern society. In fact, it's far more so than the hunter characteristics. How do you succeed? And as I was writing the first book on ADHD, one of our next door neighbors was a flight attendant, and her husband, who we didn't see so much because he flew all the time, although she did too, but she was home more often, was a pilot at Delta Airlines. And so I'm not a commercial pilot, but I have a private pilot's license. And so he got me into one of the pilot's lounges out at the Atlanta airport, and I'm sitting here with my basic DSM test, you know, for the simple test for ADHD back, this would be the mid-80s. And I just went up to pilots and said, I reprinted it, and I had taken off ADHD and put psychological profile on the top. And I said, you know, I'm just doing a study on the profile of pilots. Do you mind answering some questions? Oh, yeah, I'm pleased to do it, most of them. And as they go through the checklist, you'd see this pattern of ADHD emerging. So often I would have pilots describe to me the life of a pilot being hours and hours and hours of sheer boredom, punctuated by moments of sheer terror. And when they said sheer terror, they would always smile. You know? It's like, oh, that's what you live for. And it was quite remarkable. I was giving this talk once a couple of years ago, and a fellow stood up in the back of the room and interrupted me. And I said, yes. And he said, I'm a pilot for Delta Airlines. And I thought, oh, no, I'm going to be sued for libel or something. I should never. And he said, and I have ADHD. I said, really? He said, I can't take medication for it. I'm a pilot, but I don't need medication. All I need to do is get in a plane and fly through a thunderstorm. He said, there's plenty of arousal. There's a million things going on in the cockpit. He said, you're going to find your best pilots are people who were fighter pilots, and your fighter pilots were all ADD. So he said, this is, of course. And then he said, but the real message I wanted to share with your audience, and I said, oh, okay, what's that? He said, it's not just Delta Airlines. Which even gives us a clue to how to teach ADHD kids. So when I first laid this out, I wrote this book back in 1990, 91. I published it in 92, as I recall. called, the original title that I'd submitted to the publisher was Hunter in a Farmer's World. But publishers are enormous, famously irascible, and so he changed it to ADD, A Different Perception, which I thought was a dreadfully boring title. But he was a good hunter, or a good farmer, rather, and he thought, well, that, you know, that'll be fine. So I still think, you know, we should change the title. It's only been, what, 21 years. But it laid out this Hunter and a Farmer's theory, and a Farmer's World theory. And immediately the blowback came because two things happened. The first was an enormous number of parents, as most of you as clinicians know, if you have an ADHD kid, odds are fairly high you have an ADHD parent, at least one, or something close to it. And a lot of parents read this book, which I had actually written to my son as much as anything else, read this book, and in this book they saw themselves. And they saw their kids, of course. And the primary message of the book was, you are not disordered. This is a story of how I learned the importance of self-esteem. There is, when we were running the program in New Hampshire, and I mentioned, you know, the challenges of the kids that we had for intake. We had one little girl come in on a Friday afternoon. Friday was like, you know, the social workers work Monday through Friday, but the kids are having challenges 7 days a week. And the social worker brought this child by, 7-year-old girl, brought her by, maybe 8 years old, brought her by on a Friday afternoon around 4 o'clock in the afternoon and said, Shannon was the little girl's name. She said, Shannon's social worker is out sick this week. I don't know her case history. I don't have legal access to her files. What I do know is that she has to spend the night someplace. She can't go home. And that I'm very reluctant to put her in the children's detention facility, which was the only other option. Can you take her at least over the weekend as an emergency placement? And I said, yeah, sure, we'll take her as an emergency placement. And that night, Karen, who was the house parent in that house that we put Shannon into, Louise and I lived in the house next door. Shannon seemed like a normal 7 or 8 year old in most respects. You know, she was kind of well behaved, kind of a little shy. Karen took her up and said, it's time to go to bed. Here's a nightgown for you to put on, and I'll come back and tuck you in 10 minutes. And she came back a few minutes later, and Shannon had changed into her night clothes and was sitting on the bed, and Karen sat down and was going to read her a story or just talk to her. And she just reached over and said, so how are you, Shannon? And just touched her on the back, just touched her. And the moment she touched her, Shannon exploded, started screaming at her, coming after her with her fingernails, you know, screaming, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to burn you, and just all of this violent rage. And so Karen, in order to prevent Shannon from hurting her or hurting herself, and, I mean, she was flinging herself around, basically just physical, basic kind of physical restraint 101, you know, just held her, and all the time she's trying to talk her down. You know, it's okay, Shannon, don't worry, I'm here with you, I care about you, everything's fine, you're safe. And finally, after 5 or 6 minutes of pretty intense struggle, which for those of you who've been through restraint, you know that's a long time, although some can be much longer, but Shannon was basically immobilized, laying on the bed, just, you know, panting and kind of decompressing. And Karen looked down, and in the struggle, Shannon's nightshirt had gotten hiked up to the point where Karen could see the skin on her back, and it was covered with cigarette burns. When we conduct ourselves through life, we tend to put ourselves in a box and say, this is me right here. These are the borders of the box. There's a floor on which we stand, a ceiling above which we don't go, typically, walls out of which we don't pass. And these boxes tend to be created not by us, but for us, by the adults in our lives when we're children. And the boxes are filled with stories. We live our life by stories. There's no objective reality. really, for a kid, at least in terms of self-identity and all that sort of thing. There's the stories that we acquire from our parents, from our peers, and from our culture as a whole, from our teachers, from our schools, from everything else. And the story that Shannon had acquired was that she was the little girl who was so evil, so bad, so terrible in her behavior, that the only way to control her was to put cigarettes out on her. And she really believed that. And over the course of the next 2 years that she was in our program, the first 6 months anyway, she tested every single person in that program, every single adult.
She approached you.
And I mean, there was 1,000 variations in it, but it was all meta to one simple thing. And that was saying to that adult, okay, I'm going to challenge you and you're going to confirm to me that I'm so evil somebody has to put a cigarette out on me or it's equivalent. And instead what she got from all of the adults in our program over and over and over again was, that's not the person you are. You're a good person, you're a decent person, you're a smart person, you're a person that can care, and you're a person that we care about, and we're gonna make this work for you, and this is a safe place. Oh no, I'm terrible. Oh, no, you're not. And if I have to hold you and tell you that I love you, and that's why I'm holding you, I will do that. But whatever it is, it's not going to be the reaction that Shannon had always gotten up until that point in her life. And it was amazing to watch over the course of those 2 years, this young woman who had come in so damaged, change her internal story about who she was to becoming an honor student in school and doing very well and having a nice circle of friends and seeing that previous life as no longer a gut punch, vivid, bright, feeling it in their body all the time, but rather it had kind of gone off distant and become black and white pictures in the past, and all the submodalities associated with the recollections of her earlier life had shifted, and her behaviors shifted because her sense of self shifted. And that was why when Louise and I were sitting in that psychologist's office, the educational testing specialist, listening to our son be told he had a brain disease, a brain disorder, that was going to cause him to fail in life, I thought, that's not a story I want my son telling himself through life. It's not the story I told myself. Now, I was in some ways rescued. They put us in this fast-track learning program where it was like, you can learn anything you want as fast as you want. We had basically one-on-one tutors, you know, right through 12 years old through sixth grade. And by sixth grade, by 12 years old, I was reading at college level. I was doing math, calculus and trig. I'd taken physics, the entire high school repertory of physics and chemistry, and basically had completed high school. In fact, when I was 14, I got a summer scholarship to Michigan State University in biology. And I am convinced that if I had had to sit in the boring, normal classrooms for those first years of my life, I would have ended up like several of my three younger brothers, diagnosed as being highly intelligent, ADHD, give them Ritalin, and put on pharmaceuticals. But it didn't happen to me. Instead, I came through with my self-esteem inflated, or maybe inflated is the wrong word, solid, intact. You know, I didn't think I was Superman, but I thought, I can do things. I can accomplish things. I'm not afraid to step out. And I think that that has served me throughout my life. Louise and I have started a number of things that people say, how could you do that? Well, we just did. We believed we could. And so these stories become crucial. And I wanted to start by sharing with you a short quote from one of Sherlock Holmes, one of Arthur Conan Doyle's, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's novels. This is Sherlock Holmes, a Sherlock Holmes story called The Sign of the Four. And here it's written by Watson, of course, Holmes' associate, protege, and medical doctor, physician. And he walks into the room, and Holmes is rolling up his sleeve, preparing to inject something into his arm. And Watson says to him, "Which is it today?" I asked, "Morphine or cocaine?" He raised his eyes languidly from the old black-letter volume which he had opened. "It is cocaine," he said, "a 7% solution. Would you care to try it?" And Watson, of course, said, "No, no, indeed. My constitution has not gotten together after the Afghan campaign, et cetera." And then you know, he basically gives Holmes his "you shouldn't be taking drugs" speech. And Holmes, he smiled at my vehemence. "Perhaps you are right, Watson," he said. "I suppose that the influence is physically a bad thing. I find it, however, so transcendently stimulating and clarifying to the mind that its secondary action is a matter of small element, or small moment." And then Watson gives him another anti-drug speech, "should be taking cocaine." And this is Sherlock Holmes's response. And this is where we're going to get into Abe Maslow and neurology and the DRD4 genes and dopamine and everything. He said to Holmes, Sherlock Holmes said to Watson, he said, "My mind rebels at stagnation. Give me problems. Give me work. Give me the most abstruse cryptogram or the most intricate analysis, and I am in my proper atmosphere. I can dispense with altogether with artificial stimulants. I can, but I abhor the dull routine of existence. I crave for mental exaltation. That is why I have chosen my own particular profession, or rather created it, for I am the only one in the world." And then Watson says, "the only unofficial detective." And he goes on into this, you know, the only basically kind of crazy detective. Sherlock Holmes was, you know, a case study in ADHD and brilliance in many regards. And his experiments, his use of cocaine, obviously he's a fictional character, but I think Doyle saw that, and that there was very much of that day. So how is it that these kids can't sit through a classroom? What is the situation that causes us to say, under certain circumstances, that some of these children are disordered or damaged? What might it be? Back in the 1960s, Abraham Maslow, one of the more famous American psychologists, humanistic psychology and all this, came up with what is often referred to as Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. And he actually, during his lifetime, never characterized it as a pyramid. In fact, he would flunk students who tried to do so. He thought it should be a line. But since his death, everybody uses it as a pyramid. And it's easy to conceptualize in this way. And the classic is that there's two pieces to this that are really interesting. First of all, there's the physiological needs. We need to breathe, drink, regulate our body temperature, use the bathroom, you know, just basic physiological needs. Breathe, I think I said that. Once those needs are met, then we concern ourselves with safety. Are we in a safe environment? Is the world a safe place? You know, are we secure? You know, things like that. And then once those needs are met, then people concern themselves with the basic social needs. Interacting with others, you know, being functional in society, basic social needs. Once those needs are met, then self-esteem, and these also, this involves the interpersonal, highly social, you know, falling in love, having relationships, you know, going, respect for others, you know, the more intense levels, the more subtle levels of the social needs. And once these are fulfilled, then in Maslow's hierarchy of needs, people seek self-actualization, spiritual insight, philosophical insight, understanding, self-understanding, self-realization, creativity, problem-solving, that whole spectrum of things. Now, this is pretty much not in dispute these days. I mean, since Maslow came up with this, arguably in the 50s, it was widely published in the 60s, it's become basically, you know, Psych 101, intro to psych class. And the other part of this is that if a person is stuck in any one of these spots, everything above them vanishes. So if somebody were to come up to you from behind and put a plastic bag over your head and tie it off and challenge your physiological needs, you wouldn't be thinking about, you know, how to... how to get into a relationship with that person that you are thinking about, or you wouldn't be thinking about what's the meaning of life, or you know whether or not next week at the institution you're going to be comfortable speaking in front of a group of people. You wouldn't be all that concerned about safety, tearing that plastic bag off so you could take a breath. You know, so what if I fall off my chair, you know, and perhaps injure my shoulder? It doesn't matter. I need a breath. So everything above that point would cease to exist in that moment. We're all clear on this. Similarly, if your safety is challenged, if you are crossing a busy street and suddenly you're in the middle of the street and the lights change and cars are zooming by on either side of you, inches away, and you have, you know if you take a step, you'll be bug splat on a windshield completely unintended. And in that moment, as safety is at risk, you're not, again, thinking about, maybe I'll bring roses to my wife, or, you know, maybe the meaning of life, the Trinity is not the best way to describe, you know, I mean, if none of these things are going to be going through your mind. What's going to be going through your mind is, how do I get out of it? You know, how do I make it through this? So now I'd like to add something to this that is not taught in psychology classes or not taught in Maslow theory. And that is that there is a need that Maslow overlooked. There's a chapter in one of my books, What Maslow Overlooked, that describes this. I think I published it on the internet a few places. And the reason why I think he overlooked it is because he himself, being more farmer than hunter, didn't explicitly acknowledge it as a separate need, because he felt that it was constantly fulfilled. And that's the need to experience one's own aliveness. I would suggest to you that this need to know that you're alive is right here, below the social needs and above safety. It might even be here, below safety and above physiology. In fact, actually, this is more likely when it's really severe. Here's the question. Why is it that an ADHD child will engage in risky behavior? Why is it that ADHD kids are more likely to engage, whether it's sexually or experimenting with drugs, or whether it's joining a gang or whatever it may be? Why are they more likely to engage in risky behavior? Well, if there is a need to be alive, let's put it right here too. Why would somebody challenge safety? In fact, let's actually move the whole thing down there. Well, that need to be alive, how do we know that we're alive? The way that we know that we're alive is through our senses. There's a part of the brain called the thalamus, way back there, and the small kind of almost a walnut-shaped thing. And the nerves, all of the sensory nerves, except from the olfactory bulb, except the sense of smell, which is unmediated, which is why if you walk into certain environments, like my father had 20,000 books, and my grandmother owned an antique store and had probably another 20,000 books. And whenever I walk into a library, I'm 6 years old again. I mean, it's just the smell, boom, I'm right there. And so the sense of smell is not mediated by the thalamus. But from the eyes, it goes into the thalamus. From the ears, it goes into the thalamus. From our sense of balance, the vestibular system, goes into the thalamus. The sense of touch and several of the different senses of touches go into the thalamus. So basically we have all of our sensory inputs, except for smell, and our taste buds go into the thalamus. And then they radiate out from the thalamus into the rest of the brain via some of the fastest nerves in the brain here. And the thalamus in some ways could be considered, for purposes of this argument, this is, speak to a neurophysiologist or a neurologist and you'll get it, but this is a gross oversimplification, and yet there's a lot of accuracy to it.
You could think of the thalamus as a volume control. A volume control that is defined genetically. And one of the mechanisms that can change that volume control is dopamine. So here we are on the spectrum. And if you were to, we're all familiar with sensory deprivation tanks, where you lay in a tank and you can't see anything, you can't hear anything, you can't feel anything. People immediately go into dream states and things like that. Some people actually can't handle it, many people. But there's a point at which there's not enough sensory input to tell you that you're alive. I mean, how do we know that we're alive? We know that we're alive because we're seeing what we're seeing, we're hearing what we're hearing, we're feeling what we're feeling. I mean, we're present. Oh, I'm alive. So what if there's this threshold, to arbitrarily put it here, on the spectrum of sensory input, of volume control of the thalamus? And if you were born with your thalamic gain here as your normal set point, then you never doubt whether or not you're alive, because as you're going through your life, you know, your thalamic gain will vary depending on circumstances and conditions and environment and pharmaceuticals and whatnot. But it's pretty much always, you never, the question of am I alive never becomes a serious question. And that's true of most people. But for somebody, particularly the hyperactive variant of ADHD, for somebody who's born with their thalamic gain set here, or even worse, way down here, little Johnny is sitting in his classroom, and his teacher is droning on, and his mind, I mean, keep in mind, if we posit this as a need, right, everything below this point, these are absolute needs. These are luxuries to survive as a human. These are needs to survive as a human. So, anyway, I'm not sure what to do about that. So little Johnny is sitting in his classroom. Don't let ADD adults near your, we should raise this thing. So little Johnny is sitting in his classroom, and the teacher's droning on, and he's feeling the back of his brain, his deep mental processes are saying, you're not alive, you're not alive, danger, danger, right? Because he's not experiencing aliveness. There's not enough sensory input. So he reaches out and grabs little Sally's ponytail sitting in the chair in front of him and pulls on it. And she goes, ah! And everybody in the class looks at him, and the teacher glares at him, and all of a sudden he gets a little adrenaline rush, and that kicks up his sensory input, because adrenaline does turn up the thalamus, and suddenly, and you know, it turns up our entire metabolism, and suddenly he's above the threshold, and he goes, ah, I'm alive. The teacher's coming at him, right? Oh, I'm alive, I don't care, you know? It's worth the price. And then he pays the price, and 15, 20 minutes goes by, or, you know, for some kids it's actually, well, in this case, 15 or 20 minutes goes by, and his neurology settles back down again, and oh my goodness, I'm not alive, I'm not alive, I'm not alive, what am I going to do? And so he wads up a little piece of paper and gets it all wet, and he throws a spitball at Billy over there, and Billy goes, oh, what's that? You know, and suddenly, and it starts all over again. And of course, boom, he pops up above this. And these periodic eruptions above this threshold are what we call hyperactive outbursts. Right? These are the hyperactive moments. Or what we might call, in some adults and in other circumstances, the moments when people make just terrible, terrible decisions. When they decide to engage in risky behavior that's genuinely risky and they probably shouldn't be doing. You know, let's try this drug. Let's have unprotected sex, those kinds of things. Could be coming out of these. What we see very often, the presentation of ADHD in girls, is that they are interrupting absolutely as much as the boys are. It's just that the boys are interrupting in visible external ways. They're making jokes. They're interrupting people's conversations. They're throwing the spitballs. They're doing whatever. They're interrupting things in ways that are externalized. The girls are interrupting in ways that are internalized. They're having conversations inside their own heads about something, or something that is said leads them off on some other journey, and now, and then 4 minutes later they suddenly remember, oh, I'm supposed to be paying attention and listening, and now they're brought back. Oh. And this is the classic presentation of ADHD in girls, and it's very often described in disparaging terms, as you know, the dumb blonde jokes in American society, and I don't know the equivalent here since, you know, so many Swedes are blonde. Maybe it's the opposite. Maybe it's dumb brunettes. I don't know, but they're described as being inattentive or as not being so smart or not really caring, when really they may care a lot and they may be brilliant. But they're easily distracted by their own internal dialogue. They're easily distracted, and that distraction leads to internal dialogue rather than external dialogue. And because it's not happening on the outside, it's only happening on the inside, nobody notices, because nobody notices, nobody intervenes. And then you end up with somebody 20, 30, 40 years old who has had a lifetime of challenges that could have been, their life could have been much easier if somebody had intervened much earlier. Or, for that matter, even at the age of 30, 40, 50, 60, with that self-awareness, now here's an opportunity to challenge it, to look for ways to bring more stimulation into life, to look for, you know, learning environments and teaching environments that are more interesting, to find relationships that are interesting, and not just romantic relationships, friend relationships, business relationships. All the various things that men and women both go through. And so this unique presentation of ADHD in girls, I find to be so rarely discussed, and given that women and girls are half our population, really important. I mean, even if they were only a small percentage, it would be really important, but we're talking massive underdiagnosis or underreporting or response as a consequence of this, as a consequence of this acculturation, and so I think it's a really important thing that acculturation be acknowledged. Now, for some kids who are born way down here, you see these eruptions every 5, 10, 15 minutes. For some kids who are born with their thalamic gain right here, or let's say right here, you might see them go through most of their lives, and then they kind of wander into here, and maybe once every 3 or 4 years, they will do something that pops them back up there. And so you see people, and I'm guessing I'm more in that position, because I basically have reinvented my life every 5 or 6 years. Louise and I, when we were first married back almost 40 years ago, made the decision that we weren't going to retire when we got old. We were going to retire throughout our lives. We were going to enjoy life while we were young. And we've built 7 businesses. One of them, the children's program, we made no money from. It's a nonprofit. But we've built 6 for-profit businesses and sold them and retired in each case and taken a year or 2 or 3 years off. And 1 year we lived in Germany and traveled all around Europe and other circumstances. And, you know, for some of our kids, that's been great fun. And for some, it's like, why is mom and dad always, you know. But I think that there's an explanation here. And I think with this need to be alive, this need right here, or maybe even here, to fundamentally know that you are alive. The main 2 things that this tells us, if there is truth to this hypothesis, and I believe not only is there proof, but it's demonstrable, is that, first of all, Johnny pulling on Susie's ponytail is not a moral decision. It's a survival decision. Now, it is, we can argue morality, but historically, prior to the 60s and 70s, with the diagnosis of hyperactivity and hyperkinesis, these children were simply considered bad kids. And even today, many people regard them as bad children, as being morally deficient. And if you look at it in this context, you get it. This has nothing to do with morality. That's going to be shaded by circumstances of growing up and birth and value systems and what they, you know, from their culture, from their parents, from their religion, from their society as a whole, all those things. But that this is not an issue of good or wrong, bad, right or wrong. It's an issue of needing to be alive. And the second and perhaps most dramatic thing that this tells us is that if we can artificially grab little Johnny's thalamic gain, his pumping into the reticular activating system, his level of aliveness, and drag it up above this line and set it right here, with, for example, 10 milligrams of Ritalin, in the case of Sherlock Holmes, a 7% solution of cocaine, then he's going to be sitting there in the class going, wow, I'm fully alive. I can see what I can see, I can hear what I can hear, I can feel what I can feel, there's no doubt in my mind I'm alive. And once that need for aliveness is met, the dysfunctional or abreactional behaviors, the dysfunctional is probably the best word, behaviors that people engage in, particularly children, to stimulate themselves or to rattle their environment so that their environment will stimulate them to cause them to feel that they're alive, to kick up their dopamine levels, to kick up their, and all the associated neurochemicals and hormones from adrenaline on down. Those behaviors go away because they're not necessary anymore. It also explains why not, first of all, it also explains why not all kids, why it's so important if you're going to use stimulant medication. And I'm not a big fan of stimulant medication, and I'll explain what I would do as an alternative, but I do recognize that there are many kids who you actually have to, you've got to do this. You know, those who were born way down here, there may be fewer than 1% of classrooms in Sweden that are sufficiently high in levels of stimulation that they're going to keep that kid above this threshold. So, you know, a little bit of help from their friends, right? As adults, the way that the ADHD adults do this is typically with caffeine. Self-stimulation, self-medication. Okay. But what is it doing? It's raising the levels of arousal, which is making, I'm alive, I'm aware, I'm awake. So number one, it tells us that titration is really important because really all we need to do is get them just above that threshold and then teach them this, because if we can get them just above that threshold, then they're paying attention and we can teach them living and coping skills that they can continue to carry on when they're not in a medicated state, when they're below that threshold. We can teach them how to self-stimulate, for example. The important thing here is not the nature of the behaviors, it's what's driving them. And so if we're going to use medication, the goal of the medication should be the minimum dose necessary to get above that threshold, rather than a large enough dose to just wham the kid or whatever, or the adult for that matter. So what can these children do? How do we teach them how to get above that threshold when they're below that threshold without using medication if that's not an option available to them or if that's considered undesirable by them or their family or their physician? And in a situation that might not be the optimal situation, basically I would suggest there are two choices. One choice is to change the child's environment. For our son, who was also genetically me, he was not doing all that well in the public school and was having challenges. And so we went to the teachers in his public school and we said, you have a class called advanced placement, AP classes. And the teacher said, yeah, those are for the smart kids. And we said, well, our son is one of the smart kids. He's got a high IQ. I can demonstrate that. In fact, that was one of the things that the educational testing specialist had told him. He said, you've got an IQ that's very good. And in fact, one of the major problems of ADHD is that people with ADHD take tests badly. So your IQ is probably 10 or 15 points higher than this test indicates. So you're a smart kid. So anyhow, we went to the school and we said, fine, put him in the advanced placement class. And they said, but that's for our smart kids. And your kid has a D average, you know, a bad average education. And we said, but he'll do well in those classes because those are small classes. There's a level of mentorship with the teachers. The kids can learn at their own pace. I mean, these are all the things that would make these children very highly successful. And you're sticking him in a classroom with a bunch of average kids who he's way ahead of, and he's bored silly. And they said, well, we can't put him in the AP class because you have to have an A grade level to get into the AP class. And I said, so let me get this right. You have to prove that you can be a successful farmer in the farmer classroom before you can get promoted into the hunter classroom? And they, at that point, the discussion kind of devolved. We obviously didn't get what we wanted from the public school system, so we looked around schools in Atlanta, and we found a school in downtown Atlanta that was actually educationally, academically run by the teachers. The teachers had, you know, there was a solid curriculum. Final say, the teachers were God when it came to the curriculum. This was not up for negotiation. But in every other regard, the children ran the school. The children's school council made all the decisions. So from dress code to behavior, one of the decisions that they made was that you don't have to sit in your chair, for example. When we went to visit this school, I walked into a classroom, and here's one kid sitting literally on the teacher's desk. The teacher's standing next to him lecturing. There's another kid laying on the floor with his, you know, he's watching, his head is up against the wall. There's another kid sitting in the windowsill. There's two or three children sitting on their desks rather than at their desks. I would say just only slightly fewer than half of the kids in this class, and it was maybe 20 kids in the classroom, were actually sitting in a desk. And the kids were challenging the professor, the teacher. And this was seventh grade. These were 13-year-olds. And they were having a debate with the teacher, and it was very spirited, and they would just pop up and, you know, nobody raising their hand or anything. They were just having this debate. And I thought, my first thought was, this is a classroom that is totally out of control. This would be a disaster for my son. I don't think anybody should go to a school like this. Right? This is a mess. And then I start, and, you know, sometimes you have a preconception, and then you listen and get just a little bit more information, and all of a sudden everything changes. Your whole view of the world just changes. I stood there for a minute in my judger mode, right? What kind of classroom is this? You know, And then I started listening to what these kids and this teacher were arguing about with such passion. And what they were arguing about was that if E equals mc squared, if the energy in a piece of matter is equivalent to the mass of that matter times the speed of light squared, if that's really true, if E equals mc squared as a formula is true, then the time and mass dilation theories that, the you know, T equals 1 over the square root of m minus 1 over, I forget the whole theory, but any, the time and mass dilations that both hypothesize that it's impossible to go faster than the speed of light, and once you do, mass becomes infinite, that those actually contradict the original theory. And the students were like, no, this is how it is. And they were like doing the math, and the teacher was like, no, this is how it is. And they were arguing about the math of Einstein's theory of relativity. 13-year-olds. And at that moment, I thought, my son's going to love this. And we put him in that school, and in a year in that school, he jumped 3 years in the equivalent in the public school and suddenly was a straight-A student. And we went back to the public school and said, will you take an A student and put him in your AP class, in your advanced placement? Oh, of course! And he did well, and he now has a master's degree in the biological sciences, and which is what he had told that original career counselor he wanted. Now, it took him a few more years of college than the average kid to get, and some of that he punctuated by becoming a teaching assistant, teaching and not carrying a full load. And another strategy that he developed that I thought was brilliant, that is available to college kids and should be, frankly, available to kids below college level, is every semester when he was anticipating his next semester, he would audit a class. Auditing a class is where you can, with the permission of the teacher, you can show up for a few days or a few weeks and sit in. You get no credit for it, but you can be in the classroom. And so he would show up and he'd spend a day or two in a classroom, and it wasn't, you know, what's the content or is this a subject that I'm interested in, because there are certain classes you have to take in order to graduate. The question was, is this teacher interesting enough to hold my interest that I can sit in his classroom for a full semester? Or is this one of those teachers who just stands in one place and talks in a monotone for a whole hour and, you know, everybody who's really good at taking notes gets it and everybody else is asleep, you know, or is throwing spitballs, right? And so he picked out his teachers, and I thought, this is brilliant. You know, this is just these adaptive strategies. And carrying these adaptive strategies forward into life. You know, the big question, how do we know that we're alive? There's, and again, the answer, of course, is through our senses, through our sensory input. How can we control our sensory input outside of medication, outside of drinking a second cup of coffee, or taking some Ritalin, or if you want to depress your sensory input, taking a barbiturate? How can we modulate, or drinking alcohol, how can we modulate those things? This very simple technique, and I'll just walk you all through it. What this allows is for a child to put himself into basically a learning trance. Trance states are highly focused states. Most people think that they're lack of consciousness. They're actually hyper-conscious. A trance state is a highly focused state. And so how do you bring yourself to here and now, this moment, in such a way that you can highly focus? Well, just follow along here. Just walk through this with me. Notice what you're seeing. Notice the amount of light in the room. Notice the colors around you. Notice, be just very aware of the visual world. We live in a world filled with light. It's amazing. All, everything that you can see. This whole visual, the screen up here, everything. And now shift senses and notice what you are hearing and the sound in the room. Some people moving, the silence. There's no air conditioning much going. The silence between my words, the tone of my voice. People upstairs. We're in a sea of sound. And now notice the sensations in your body, the physical body. Notice that gravity is pulling your butt down on the seat of the chair, and that your feet are in shoes. They may be tight or loose, but there are your feet on the floor. Notice how warm or cool you feel. Notice the senses of your body, and just be present with that. And now notice any taste in your mouth, the leftover from a cup of coffee or some tea or a juice. Just notice your sense of taste. And now notice how you are vertical relative to the room. This is your vestibular system, your inner ear, another sense. Notice position. Notice how everything is vertical and horizontal by and large. And your sense of balance. You might even challenge it a little bit. That's interesting. And now notice what you see again. And all the color. And then mix that with what you're hearing. And all the sound. And mix that with what you're feeling. And the taste. And being vertical, and just come to this moment. And you're fully present. And if you can teach that to an 8-year-old, you can teach them a powerful tool for the moment when they feel hyperactive. Because those of you who just walked through that with me probably noticed that there's that sense of, wow, I'm here. And in fact, in Zen practice and in Vipassana, you know, it's like this will, you know, you want enlightenment, you want to experience enlightenment, do this. just sit with your senses and just cycle through them and be present. Don't even, it's not even necessary to repeat a mantra or visualize something or be saying prayer beads. I mean, these are all different ways to do these kinds of practices. But what this does is by, let's say that you are genetically here in general, but if we kick in a little extra awareness of the visual and a little extra awareness of the auditory and a little extra awareness of the kinesthetic, the body, then where are we? We're above that threshold. What are the jobs or job skills that might be useful to carry you forward with a neurology that occasionally causes you to think that maybe you're not alone? In other words, what's going to stimulate you? What's going to keep you interested? What's going to keep you vital? And there's frankly no shortage of them out there. You know, whether it's being a pilot or a flight attendant, or whether it's being a salesperson, or whether it's being at the executive levels. You know, I would say that probably many CEOs are diagnosable as ADHD. Most of the ones that I've known, and I've known some at the very highest levels, were off the scale. That's how they got there. I mean, they're brilliant hunters. So, whether it's, and in the sciences you find them, particularly in the research sciences. So if you know, using this kind of hunter-farmer spectrum, if you can use that hunter-farmer spectrum as a highly simplified tool to help kids make career choices, say, well, what are the hunter jobs out there, you know, that you might want to consider pursuing? And as I said, there's no shortage of them. Another thing that I'd like to share with you is the concept of communication using modalities. How do we most effectively communicate with these folks? How do we most effectively communicate with each other? As we were going through the senses here, I pointed out that, you know, we basically have six senses. Hearing, seeing, feeling, vestibular system, tasting, and smelling. Most people live primarily in one of three of those. About 60 or 70% of the people in the world live in a world that is visual. Now, there's good physiological reasons for this. Most of the horsepower of the brain is in the occipital region, in the visual processing region. We remember in pictures. They see the world. And they reveal the fact to you that they see the world by the way that they use language. They will say things like, yes, I see what you're saying. And, that's clear. I see the point. The second group of people, which comprise maybe 20 or 30% of the population, are people who are highly auditory. Their principal sense that's out in front of the others, instead of being their sense of vision, is their sense of hearing. And auditory people reveal their auditoriness by the way that they speak, typically. And they will say things like, oh yeah, I hear what you're saying. That sounds good to me. Great hearing your voice. At the end of a conversation, I'll talk with you later. The third group is kinesthetic. Kinesthetic are, and this is a very small percentage of people. These are people who live in their feelings. This is maybe 5 or 10% of the population. And they will say things like, I've got a great feeling for that. Oh, that's a solid concept. Yeah, I can get my arms around that. The other thing that you typically find about people who are auditory, visual, or kinesthetic is that athletes tend to be kinesthetic. Why? They live in their bodies. So you find a lot of people are very, very good athletically. Their primary sensory modality is kinesthetic, their body. People who make a living writing or talking very often are auditory, primarily auditory. Now, this doesn't exclude the other senses. They're all there. It's just which one is front and center. And for some people, some people are multimodal. Some people have fairly high levels of all three, although that's pretty rare also. And auditory people can do auditory memory, which is very difficult for most people to do. And then visual people, you can very often spot them, because visual people tend to stand up, have their chest out, their appearance is perfect, everything, very carefully considered their appearance, because they're visual. And they're imagining, people are looking at them, and they're look because they're looking at other people. Whereas auditory people, they tend to lead with their ear, actually. You'll see them slouch a little bit, and they're listening to sound, and they might not be quite so perfect in every regard in their clothing, which is not to put them down at all. It's just, you know, the same with kinesthetic people. So in our family, for example, I'm very auditory. I started in radio when I was 16 years old as a weekend DJ, and I'm back in radio again. I have 23 books in print in 17 languages on 5 continents, but I've written 35 books, and started writing, you know, poetry for publication when I was a teenager. I love sounds. I love words. I'm just highly auditory. The slightest sound in the middle of the night wakes me up. It's just that's the world I live in. My wife, on the other hand, is highly. We've talked about this in the public before. Is highly visual, and not so auditory. And one of our kids is highly kinesthetic. In fact, among our kids, our oldest is highly visual. In fact, she has a degree in graphic arts. Our son, our middle child, is very kinesthetic. And kinesthesia, being primarily kinesthetic and being ADHD, is like a real challenge because we don't teach kinesthetically. If you want to, you know, our teaching systems are primarily set up to be auditory, which is not the majority of people. And, you know, which is why, you know, visual aids are becoming popular and things like that. But we don't teach kinesthetically. The old Socratic method, where you'd have a teacher and a student standing asking each other questions, that's as kinesthetic as it is verbal. But that's very rare. And our youngest is highly auditory. She got my genes, the oldest got Louise's. One Christmas, we're sitting around trying to decide all together, the five of us. The kids are adults now. They're all in their late 20s and through their 30s. And trying to decide where we're going to go, what movie we're going to go to on Christmas. We were together for Christmas. And our oldest, the visual one, we've got the newspaper out on the table. And our oldest says, that looks like a good movie to me. Of course, she's visual. And our youngest said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea, the auditory one. But our kinesthetic one is looking at it, and he can't quite make up his mind, because he's got a picture and he's got some words there, but he has no sense of this movie. And so, you know, he's like not quite sure. And so finally I just interjected. I said, you know, how does it feel, what little you know about that movie? And he said, well, it feels okay. I said, okay, well then let's go. Right? Because his decision-making processes were kinesthetic. And similarly, Louise and I will have conversations. In fact, we had one just a couple days ago where it was like this. It's funny, after being married almost 40 years, and she'll say, you know, she'll say something, and then she'll say, do you see what I mean? And now, as a joke, you know, I'll say, no, I don't see it at all, but I hear it. and then she'll say, no, seriously, do you see it? Do you see what I'm talking about? And because, you know, it's like, she still doesn't get my bad joke. And finally I'll say, yeah, I see what you're talking about. And if I want her to know that I understand what she's saying right off, I'll start using visual language rather than auditory language. One of the things that's really interesting is that the unconscious mind is not capable of filtering the word you when it's told in the second or third person. And this is pretty much regardless of language. Because the unconscious mind can't filter it, you can tell stories in the third person that a person will, at a conscious and intellectual level, understand at the third person, but at an unconscious and deeper level, they will take if it's useful. And this is one of the really interesting dimensions of this. This is derived out of this, you know, out of studies in hypnosis, basically. One of the really interesting things about it is that the mind will acquire, it will take on what is useful, and it'll reject what's not. We all have very, very useful protective mechanisms within our unconscious mind. So to tell a story to a person that has an embedded you in it, in a third person, if they're in need of that, they will take it. And so, for example, when I told you the story about Shannon earlier, and I said, and this is how you tell a story. You tell a third-person story, and you use the word you. And I said, and we said to Shannon, no matter what you do, we'll always love you. No matter how you're acting out, you're a good person. No matter how difficult life has been, you have extraordinary strengths and resilience. That's what we said to Shannon. Now, all of you in the room heard that as my telling you what the story, you know, what we said to Shannon, but at the unconscious level of your mind, you also heard those things as a personal message, and your mind chose to take them or not take them. And so there's a light side and a dark side to storytelling. How do we apply these things to schools? I was in Taiwan maybe a decade and a half ago or thereabouts in a school in Taipei, and encountered a fascinating teaching technique. And I don't know that, in fact, I'm pretty sure it's not generalized nationally, but this one teacher was really, really good at this, and this particularly works well for ADHD kids. And you know, generally in education, it's referred to as peer teaching. The teacher stood up and laid out a principle, wrote it out on the board and explained it in this 1 hour class. Took about 10 minutes to explain the concept. And then turned to the class and said, now how many of you understand this? And there were about 50 kids in this class. It's a large classroom. And six or seven children raised their hand. And so the teacher then stepped back and said, okay, you teach that now. And so groups formed around those six or seven who were they stood up. The ones who had raised their hands, they stood up. And groups formed around them, and they taught their peers. And as what the teacher then did was walked from group to group to make sure that they were actually being taught correctly, you know, that the information was accurate. And when the people who were sitting understood it, they stood and helped the child who was teaching teach. Until over the course of the hour, every child in the classroom was standing. It was like learning had just moved across this classroom like a wave. And when you think about it, you know, one of the really important concepts is that our educational system is a vestige of the Industrial Revolution. Our schools are set up as assembly lines. And it, you know, they're set up for the standard product. And if a child comes along who's not a standard product, they get knocked off the assembly line and dumped into the waste bucket of special education or something like that. And we've developed educational techniques, by and large, that work for farmers that don't work for hunters. Whereas when you use educational techniques, be they storytelling, be they Socratic, you know, interactive with questions, challenging students, whether it be peer-to-peer teaching like I just described in Taiwan, all of these are techniques that are very hunter-friendly and are very farmer-friendly. So the extent to which we can reinvent our educational systems and our school systems in ways that work for all of our children rather than just that small segment of our children who neurologically would fit in well in the industrial age is a good thing, is a good and desirable thing. How farmers and hunters can be successful in business. Again, this has to do with things like career counseling kids, or for that matter, working with business people or entrepreneurs. Louise and I, one of the businesses that we owned, that we started actually in 1987, we started in Atlanta, an advertising agency, and we sold it in 1996 and retired from Atlanta and moved to Vermont. And that was the last time we retired before we went back to work. And sales is the essence of running an ad business, as it is the essence of most businesses. And the salespeople that we found were great hunters. I mean, being a hunter makes a great salesperson. Great hunters are great salespeople, and vice versa. The problem is they don't know how to do follow-through. Most of these were people who had never been diagnosed, they'd never been helped, many of them didn't do all that well in school, but they were brilliant salespeople. And so they'd go out on the hunt, and they would find the client, and it's like, you know, bagging the lion and bringing it back to the lair and saying, okay, I brought back the account. And then they didn't fill out the paperwork. And they didn't do the follow-up. And 2 weeks later, the call didn't. And all the farmer stuff that needs to be done once a sale is made didn't happen. And so we were losing clients as rapidly as we were acquiring them. And that's not a good thing for a business. And so Louise came up with this brilliant idea of, why don't we create pairs? Let's hire a farmer, just a basic entry-level farmer into the business, somebody who doesn't have any experience, who would like to understand the advertising business, who doesn't have any experience in sales or anything, but you know, who basically kind of an intern job, an entry-level job, but look specifically for people who are farmers, who are very detail-oriented, who are very thorough, who would love to make the follow-up calls, who would like to be involved in this, and have that person be the partner with the salesperson. I think one of the reasons that I, as a hunter, have been successful in my life is that 38 years ago I married a farmer, and a brilliant one, and who has, you know, kept me stable, as it were. And I've made her life more interesting. And she's made, and I hope, and she's made my life functional. And I counsel people to look for that, whether it's in business, whether it's in relationships. And I'm not saying that a relationship with two hunters won't work or two farmers won't work or whatever, but it's just, it's something to consider. Again, these are all value neutral things. Hey, it's a great thing being a hunter. There are some real liabilities associated with it. Hey, it's a great thing being a farmer. There are some liabilities there too. There are advantages to both and there's liabilities to both. We need to put it in a value neutral context. As people become self-aware, I think the biggest and most powerful tool is out of all of this, out of the story and everything else, is the self-awareness without the judgment. The ability to say, yes, I am learning without judging. And the way I learned it was when we were visiting the Apache, one of the tribal elders, senior people within the tribe, the political part of the tribe, I got to know quite well. It's now about midnight, and the desert is really cold. The sky was just totally black, and with the stars, it was like diamonds sprinkled on black velvet. And it seemed so huge. And in the high desert, it gets to 100 during the day. It drops down to 40 Fahrenheit at night. It was very cold, or maybe mid-40s, low 50s. But we were so hot from having sweated for 3 hours that we just sat out there and just loved the cold, you know. And we're sitting there steaming, and eight men sitting in a circle, and just telling stories. You know, guys sit around shooting the bull, as it were, and. So, and a lot of the stories that they were telling were stories about the Hopi. they would it's like one cultural group makes fun of another cultural group. And I didn't know any, and they would tend to be, you know, kind of the dumb Hopi stories or something like that. And I didn't know any stories about the Hopi. And in my culture, in contemporary American, modern American culture, the way you make a joke is you make a joke at somebody's expense. You make a put-down joke about somebody. And so, and I hadn't noticed that nobody had done that. And so when it came my turn to speak, I made a joke about the guy sitting opposite me around the fire. And all of a sudden, everybody just went silent and started looking at the fire. And I thought, oh no, I've just totally blown it. You know, because I had committed a huge cultural faux pas. I had embarrassed a person in front of his peers. I called him out. I made a joke about him. And so I was sitting there thinking, what am I going to do? How do I, you know, are they going to throw me out? Have I humiliated my friend? Have I just, you know, what, I, you know, in another time might, you know, somebody be chasing me with a tomahawk? I mean, what? And finally, the fellow to my left was the oldest man in the group, and he kind of sighed like, okay, I know this is my obligation. And he said, you know, there was a time when I was young and stupid, and I was off at school, and I made a joke about a friend of mine that hurt his feelings. And then he goes on to tell about what he did to make that right, how he corrected that. what he did with that fellow to even it out, to balance it out. And then the fellow next to him said, yeah, I remember when I was in boarding school, I did the exact same. And he tells the story of how he did it and how he evened it out. And then the next guy tells the story, and then the guy opposite me who I had made fun of, he tells his story of it and keeps going around until it gets around to me. And by the time it got around to me, I knew, because they had all taught me what I had to do with this fellow opposite me to clean it up. And I did. And harmony was reestablished. Because as a society, they're not about crime and punishment. They're about keeping the circle intact, keeping the culture intact, healing people. That when somebody breaks the law, breaks the rules, somebody steps outside, then it's our job as a society to bring them back inside, rather than, you know, America's probably the most disposable society in the world. We have more people in jail than any other country in the world, both per capita and in absolute numbers. It's a tragedy. So the idea of redeeming people, of healing people, is such an important one, both culturally and individually. And telling stories about how things are done is just a very, very powerful way to accomplish that. Another dimension of this is learning how people get that they are cared for. This was an epiphany for me. Louise and I were taking a class. It was the very first NLP class we'd taken. This was 20 years ago. And so Life turns to me, and he said, Tom, how do you know when you know that you know that Louise loves you? How do you know when to know? When you know, in other words, what's the trigger? What's the event that causes you to know? That you know with some certainty that Louise loves me. And I said, oh, that's really easy. It's when she touches me. If she hugs me, if she just walks by and puts her hand on my shoulder, I just feel loved. Now, we could play Sigmund Freud all day long and say, you know, this is because, you know, my mother carried me around a lot. And she was. My mother was very tactile. She was very kinesthetic. And there was never any doubt in my mind that she loved me. Or it's because, you know, fill in the blank. I mean, we could, you know, this childhood experience or whatever. I don't know why, but I know that even if a total stranger touches me, I feel loved. You know, it's just that's the way I'm wired. And I just always assumed everybody was like that. And so Life then turns to Louise, and he says, Louise, how do you know when you know that Tom loves you? And I'm sitting there waiting for her to say, you know, when he hugs me, when he kisses me, you know, variations on touching, you know, when we're intimate, something like that. And she said, when we have coffee together in the morning and talk. And I was like, what? I've been trying to get out of that for 20 years. It's like, I don't even like coffee. And the idea of sitting in the morning and chatting, I mean, the morning is the time when I'm fresh, I'm creative. I want to, you know, if I'm working on a project or writing a book, I want to be in front of my word processor. I don't want to be sitting there wasting time having coffee. And I couldn't figure out why ever since we were married, Louise is like, aren't we going to have coffee together this morning? No! Oh! And again, we could play Sigmund Freud. I mean, Louise's family, her father was the assistant prosecuting attorney for the state of Michigan and spent a lot of time away and spent a lot of time at work. He was prosecuting like major criminals and things. He would come home very, very late at night. He didn't see his family very much, but they always had breakfast together. So maybe that's it. Or maybe it's just something altogether different. I have no idea why that causes Louise to feel like I love her when I have coffee with her in the morning. But I got it that day. In fact, we kind of made a deal. I said, you know, because, you know, she's not a big toucher and I'm not a big coffee drinker. I said, how about you start touching me and I'll start drinking coffee with you? And here we are 20 years later. We're still together. So it worked out pretty well. Then we went back to our kids and said, how do you know that you know we didn't say it that, you know, fancy like that. What is it that I do that, or that Louise does, or that we do, that makes you know that we love you? And one of our kids was like, oh, when you tell me that you love me, that you know, that's enough. And another one of our kids was, you know, when you hug me and tell me that you love me. That was a more kinesthetic response. And then one of our kids said, when you take me to breakfast, and just one of you alone. Now this is, and for years I had been saying to this child, you know, he'd come in and, you know, 6 years old, try to wake me up on a Saturday morning saying, let's go to Waffle House, I want to have breakfast. And I'm like, no, I want to sleep in, you know. And you know, it's just you and me, let's go. And I always thought it was like, you know, he was trying to get special treatment, you know, trying to put his thumb in his sister's eye kind of thing, you know, like, you know, dad likes me better or something like, you know, I had all these theories about it. Turns out they were all nonsense. That's how he knew he was loved. And he was just basically saying, hey, you know, tell me you love me. And to say I love you doesn't have that much meaning, but having breakfast, that has a lot of meaning. This is a really simple goal setting exercise. Just asking people, okay, they say, you know, where do you want to be in 5 years? And they'll tell you a story. And then you ask, okay, well, what does that look like? And have them describe what it looks like. And they don't even have to tell you. I mean, if you have a person who's capable of inner dialogue and you know, somewhat self-aware, they can just develop it themselves. You know, what does that look like? And how do you get there? Well, I'm not really sure. Okay, well, imagine yourself there right now and look back at this moment. How did you get there? Oh, I see. It was this and this. And that was a problem. And okay, how might you get around that problem? And you know, you can expand this substantially into a conversation, you know, into a therapeutic conversation or a useful or goal-setting conversation. But it's just, it's basic timeline, use of a timeline. It's a very, you know, simple, straightforward process. Learning is a real, it's always a challenge, learning. And, you know, I've talked a lot today about how to learn through story and embedding concepts in stories. But there's another piece to learning, and that has to do with seeing. The visual cortex in the occipital region, the back part of the brain here is the most, it's where the greatest amount of horsepower is. Our brains devote enormous amount of horsepower to seeing, compared to Broca's and Wernicke's regions, these little parts of the temporal lobe, lobes that are associated with auditory processing, or the sensory motor strip that's dealing with kinesthesia and the vestibular system and whatnot. And so, how do you make something easily learnable? You make it highly visual. Just imagine a giant church, great big white church with stained glass windows. Falls out of the sky right in the middle of the street. Whoa! Right? You see what that looks like? Okay, just imagine that. And then the windows in this church start breaking out and people are sticking guns out of them and they start shooting at people. And, okay, with me on this? This is storytelling that's visual. People are shooting and of course all the people start running into their apartments all around. And hiding behind the door of the apartment because they don't want to be shot at. And they turn on their TV to see what's going on in the quiet privacy of their own apartment and safety. And they turn on the TV and the O.J. Simpson trial is going on. Remember O.J. Simpson? Yeah, it hasn't been so long. And he's sitting, you know, he's accused of murdering his wife and her and he's sitting at the defense table with a giant piece of tape over his mouth on the TV screen in the apartment across the street from where the church fell out of the sky and the guns are shooting, okay? And looking at the TV screen, and here's O.J. Simpson with a giant piece of bright orange tape over his mouth. And then the camera shifts a little bit, and you see that on his feet, instead of normal shoes, he's got these giant shoes that look like machines that like with wheels and some sort of mechanism, and the wheels are actually spinning. He's holding his shoes
a few inches above the floor, so that, because if he hits the
floor, he's going to go flying off like that, right? He's ready to fly, ready to go, ready to be very, very speedy. With me so far? Sitting there with the tape on his mouth with his speedy shoes, and opposite him is a jury, right? Of course, he's in court, and there's the jury, and the jury people are all looking at him like, look at those shoes, uh-oh, right? Wouldn't you? And now you can see the pictures, the alarmed look on the faces of these jurors, right? Big, bug-eyed, what are we going to do? And so several of the jury people start, they open the side door, and there's some bales of hay there. And so they start grabbing bales of hay and bringing them in and stacking them in front of the jury box. So if OJ flies away from that table, he'll run into the hay instead of them. Okay? These bales of hay. And so he's stacking these bales of hay. Now, pretty soon they stack up so many bales of hay that you can hardly move in there. And these people are, you know, Americans, Midwestern Americans. This was the 80s, I think, wasn't it, the OJ, the 90s, whenever it was. People wore a lot of polyester. And they're all dressed in these polyester leisure suits and things. And the polyester's rubbing up against the hay, and it's creating all kinds of static electricity. And so there's these sparks flying around from person to person among the jurors. Still with me? Okay. Sparks flying back and forth. And so some of the jurors are like, oh, we got to get out of here. This is, and so they run outside, but there's still all this static electricity. It starts flying up to the electric power lines, and shooting out through the electric power lines, and way off in New York, it browns out New York, and Los Angeles, it browns out Los Angeles, and it shuts down the city because it's bringing down the whole power grid, all this static electricity in all these states, all over the states of the United States. The power system is collapsing. Okay? Got the story? Now, if we walk the story backwards, the power system is collapsing, and the collapse is caused by what? The people wearing polyester, right? And those people are just came from behind the bales of hay. Are you with me here, going backwards on the story? And the bales of hay are there because OJ's wearing speedy shoes, right? And he's sitting there with what on his mouth? Tape. He's got tape over his mouth. And we're seeing him because we're watching a TV across the street in an apartment, in the privacy of an apartment, right? Okay, make that transition. He's on with this on TV. And we went to the apartment because they were shooting guns out of the windows of the church. Now, in the United States, I used to do a lot of consulting for school districts back when I was, this was my, ADD was, you know, I was doing a lot of ADD work. And I would say to teachers, there's no such thing as a child who can't learn. And I would have teachers say, I got kids who can't learn anything. And, you know, and I would say, give me your class for 15 minutes. And I will have every kid in that room memorize frontward and backward the Declaration or the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to the US Constitution. And they'd say, nonsense, it's impossible. The first 10 amendments to the US Constitution. Number one, freedom of religion. See the church? Guess what number two is? Guns, right? The right to have guns. Number three, oh, I missed something in the story. There were soldiers flying out of the sky. Three is easy to forget. The soldiers came down out of the sky and you know, to try and protect people. Number three, which is never used, is they can't force you to quarter soldiers in your home, which most Americans don't even know what that means, but the British used to do it. Number four, you flee to the privacy apartment. The fourth is the right to privacy. Now we see OJ with the tape over his mouth. Number five, the right to not incriminate yourself in a court of law. You don't have to speak. Number six, you look at his speedy shoes. He has the right to a speedy trial. Sixth, right to a speedy trial. Number seven, what's opposite him? The jury. You have a right to a trial by jury. It's the Seventh Amendment of the Constitution. The Eighth Amendment of the Constitution is you have the right to make bail. The Ninth Amendment to the Constitution says that all power, remember the static electricity? All power not reserved to the government in the Constitution goes to the people. And the Tenth Amendment, when the people run outside and they start shutting down the states, is that all power not taken by the people or reserved by the government goes to the states. And if you can just remember the story and see the pictures, you've now memorized the Bill of Rights, the American Bill of Rights. Here it's Sweden, for goodness sake. And But the point of the story is that if you can make things visual, and particularly absurdly visual, because the brain has so much visual capability, and this is why stories are so powerful. You tell stories and people see them, they imagine them, particularly if you use visual imagery, then you can embed memory, you can embed content in there that people carry with them for years and years and years.